You've done
anyone
this
around
with
this?
Me. You know me.
I know I'm just trying
to or confident.
Oops.
You're good. Sleep.
Yep.
Anyway.
Nice to be here.
Anyway, we're going to start now, and we're going to start the discussion, and hopefully our press panelists will show up. Thank you again for coming back. If you've already seen our panel from last year at C2E2, today's panel is called More Than Warriors and Weather Witches, The Disappearance of Nyota from the Verse. To get a little bit of an explanation why I wanted to do this panel here at C2E2 is because ever since I've been coming here, I have seen a plethora of Black women who nerded out on a level that I could never, ever achieve. But I never saw any sort of representation from the pro side. So I wanted to change that. I wanted to start changing that, to let the Black women who come to C2E2 every year faithfully know, hey, you are being recognized, you are here. And I think that's also important, especially in the media that we consume. So what I'm going to do now is introduce the panelists who are here, and I'm going to let them talk a little bit about what they do. So first, Karlyn.
Hi, I'm Karlyn Meyer. My day job, I'm an attorney. I don't practice. I work in legal education. The other hat that I put on pretty frequently is I'm on the board of Chicago Nerd Social Club, which if you'd like to follow us on Twitter, it's at Chicago Nerds, pretty simple. So I really love, seeing these moments when so many people from the city that, maybe they found their niche, maybe they haven't, kind of come together and get to have that kind of recognition of like, you're into that thing I'm into, okay, I'm not so alone right now. And that's something that happens, 1,000 times a day, on the internet or, at a meetup or something, but when you actually have a con where everyone can come together, it's just really magical. Just like Jen was saying, just kind of feeding off that energy and seeing so many people that maybe have never seen someone who looks like them that's nerding out about the same sort of things they are, but recognizing that there are a lot of us out there and we're not alone, and just kind of having that conversation about how to foster that and what we're excited about, what we're disappointed by, and how we can all do better.
Hello. Yes. Greetings, everyone. My name is Alyne Connie, and I'm a visiting instructor and also the student services librarian at the Richard J. Daley Library at the University of Illinois at Chicago. And I'm kind of pinch hitting today, but I hope I do well. I hope I make you proud. I would say that existing at the intersection of being a nerd of many facets, growing up liking sci-fi, fantasy, horror, pro wrestling, music, just consuming so many things when your identity politic intersects at being a Black woman, gives you a lot of stories to tell. You have to kind of, navigate territory in which people are surprised that you're there, amused that you're there, wondering what you're doing here. Just a lot of kind of questioning who you are and what you're doing in this space. When I first started going to conventions, I would pick up kind of those microaggressive, atmospherics from people. And it was a learning experience for me, hopefully for them. I'm also on Chicago Nerd Social Club, which is a great group of folks. Gonna stop talking now.
Hi, I'm Mikki, Kendall. So I'm less fan and more pro. I started as a fan. It's just that now I do things like write comics and books and stuff, and articles. I'm really, really bad at the self-plugging thing, but I'm gonna try it. So I was in The Swords of Sorrow series with Gail Simone. My book is Lady Rawhide vs. Miss Fury. You should totally read it. You should read the whole omnibus of that. I have a bunch of comics coming out this year. I have a short story, If God is Watching, available online for free, World Leader Magazine, and there's going to be a bunch of other stuff coming out via tour and some other places, but I can't announce titles yet. and then I write articles about random stuff like hot sauce and Beyonce and Jim Crow politics, because apparently that's how my brain works. I like my facts and my fiction. So
as you can tell, I chose some fellow panelists who don't really have anything to say about this matter. None whatsoever. So anyway, just before we get going, I have a couple of house rules that I do with every panel. They've worked with me before, they know this, so just to let you know, because we are discussing Black women's representation within science fiction, we may or may not discuss certain aspects that are triggering, like assault, or assault, racism, misogyny, and so forth and so on. So we want to let you know that if you do not hold it against anyone, if you do feel triggered by any of the discussions, feel free to get up and take a breather. We're not upset about that. Also, we will be having a question and answer section afterwards, about 15 minutes to our start time. So, and when I say question and answer, that means you guys ask the questions and we give the answers. If I hear anything that sounds like it went on for too long, I am also a cleric, so I will enact the laying of the hands upon you and say we're moving on. The third rule about my panels in particular, so you can tell, this is a panel about Black women, for Black women, created by Black women. Please know, but what about the men's? Y'all had our support for 400 years. You can give us your support for 45 minutes. With that being said, the first question about Black women's representation. Also, here are Twitter handles and the hashtags that you can use, the C-tweet-to with hashtag more than you expect. If you want to tweet or can tweet, more power to you, because I have not been able to tweet ever since this convention started. So that's it. But now for example time. I'm going to ask my panelists if they could give me an example of the good, the expected, and the WTF. And I know that we have all, by the by, I realize that two of my examples came from the same creator. I promise initially that was a coincidence.
No, it's not.
That's why I said initially. But yeah, so here are my examples. Recognize Queen Latifah from a recent stint in The Wizard of the Oz as the Wiz. What I mean by the good is that she presents as a Black woman who has obviously transcended the tropes that we usually see in media. Then below you have Tina Torres as Zoe Washburn, and she is, unfortunately, everything that we expect from the Black warrior woman trope within science fiction. And then at the top, we have, I have so many feelings about Kendra the Vampire Slayer.
That fuck-ass accent. That fuck-ass accent. I have real issues with her accent. It starts there and it all goes downhill.
For those of you who didn't know, the character Kendra was not originally supposed to have an accent, but Joss Whedon and his team, about a week before filming, said, hey, let's give her a generalized island accent to make her more exotic. So, yeah, there are loads in the way she gets. The way she gets off is just disturbing. Here's our final panelist!
Yay!
So if you quickly want to introduce yourself, we're going to start with example time.
Hi, my name is Ytasha Womack. I'm author of the book Afrofuturism, as well as the books Rayla 2212 and Rayla 2213. Time-traveling woman named
Raylan Manning. Okay. Oh, also, just to go back, that is Ytasha's handle, so if you want to tag her in anything, yes. Anyway, so examples, please. The good, the expected, and the WTF.
Okay. I'm jumping on this because I'm still not done talking about Kendra. I'm not done. Because Bianca Lawson deserved better. Bianca Lawson deserved better. Bianca Lawson deserved better. I'm sorry, I have real issues about the way Kendra was written, depicted, everything. So the WTF, I know we all like to pretend that Josh Whedon is a feminist. I kind of want to kick him in the taint. Josh Whedon and race and women of color, and particularly Black women, because Kendra is the mammy trope in less clothing. right? She has no social life, she has no friends, she has her duty. She has one shirt! One shirt. She actually says, you tore me shirt, that's me only shirt. I might kneecap him. You can go back and run tell Josh. But no, so the what the fuck portion of the day's events is not just Kendra. Oh, there's a lot of what the fuck. I have a lot of feels. A lot of feels about this. It is basically any time, because I have some what the fuck with Zoe too. And here's my what the fuck with Zoe. I really love Zoe. I wanted a little less of strong black woman. But then we get to the end. We get to Wash's death. And let me tell you something. If your depiction of a black woman's grief is nothing, fuck you. How about that? How about we just put that on the table, that the what the fuck here is her husband has just been killed in front of her, and she doesn't get to shed a single tear. Not once. Does she not get to shed a tear immediately after his death? At his funeral, she does not get to shed a single tear. We never see Zoe cry.
Well, she's hardcore like that.
Don't make me fight you. I like this whole faux hawk thing, but don't make me.
I'm teasing.
I know, I'm just playing. I'm just like, but this is literally what people will write. I just saw this thing happen in Fandom. There was something with Michonne and a picture of an ultrasound on Walking Dead. And I just saw Fandom decide that Michonne looking sad was about Daryl's pain and not about the baby Michonne lost.
Oh, we're gonna explore stuff like that.
Those are my WTFs. I have other good things, but I just needed to get those out there because you might hear about them a lot right now.
Anybody have any good?
I have a good. This is calling to your cosplay here, Martha Jones. I'm a big fan.
I'm actually cosplaying a Lisa Mazza, but that. I do actually have a Martha Jones cosplay.
Okay.
But that's too cold.
So Martha Jones, you know, she was, I got into Doctor Who with, the Ninth Doctor, and so I'm going through the companions, and it's like, oh, a companion of color, this is going to be sweet, and I fell head over heels in love with her, and I remember seeing on the internet, everyone was like, oh, we don't like Martha Jones because she has to do the, like, puppy dog love, unrequited, like, kind of thing, and it's like, sometimes love is unrequited, and that's like a complexity of life, you know, and she gets to be like a full-blooded human being who, you know, like has emotions, and things don't necessarily go perfectly for her, but she's still very intelligent, very capable, you know, plucky as hell. I loved that she felt like a person that I could be, a person I could aspire to be, but not this just magical negress, you know, that kind of descends upon things and makes everything, right? Like, she was a doctor, she was smart, she was, yeah. So Martha Jones, I get, sorry, spoilers if you haven't watched Doctor Who and Torchwood and all that stuff, but the fact that in the end she gets kind of shoehorned into, oh, there was also this other black guy, Mikki, you should get married, you do get married, you know, like that was really frustrating for me, but none of that took away from, like, Martha Jones was a well-written, full-bodied human character that was competent and charming and wonderful. Just because the doctor didn't fall in love with her, that in no way took away from her as a person. So she is still, in my heart, my favorite companion ever, and just a very good, well-written character.
I'd just like to add that as someone who jumped into watching the Doctor Who reboot rather late, as in a couple of years ago, I was also sort of thrown off by the early sort of fandom feedback that I got about Martha Jones, because once I started watching her series, her slash seasons, I also liked her a lot as well. And, you know, on a little bit of a tangent, I'm often encountering this kind of element in which the black women on particular genre shows are seen as obstacles to the narrative going correctly. And I wonder if I'm reacting to that perception within the fandom, or am I reacting to what could possibly be improved or problematic about this character. It's happening to me watching Iris on Flash. It had been happening watching Michonne on Walking Dead. I feel like once I jump back into watching Sleepy Hollow, it's probably gonna happen with Abby from what I've heard. There's just this constant, the cycle in which the black female character kind of exists as a sidekick, but cannot, even if the show started off being, you know, about that character or it's an ensemble piece, and she was a main part of that ensemble. Eventually, a large part of the fandom views that black woman as a distraction from the things that need to be happening with the main protagonist, and it's especially threatening if she's seen as like a viable romantic option. With, like, the fandom doesn't like that. This might not exactly answer that question, but I just wanted to comment on Martha Jones because I was so surprised at how much I heard people didn't like her. I was like, I think she's great, what's going on here? And then you start to interrogate what she represents and who she is and who have been companions before, and then that answers some questions perhaps.
Does anybody else have, Ytasha, do you have any?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because I think generally when there's a black woman character, there's always so many expectations around what that character should be doing, right? Because one of the narrative of people of color in film has been this negotiation around what your image is. You know, this assumption that you're not being represented as, you know, full human beings with complex emotions. And always wanting to look to different characters to satisfy that. But what becomes interesting, I think, is that in a lot of film narratives, TV show narratives, with women generally speaking, there's a lot of marginalization, particularly if the woman's not the main character. And so just as a writer, like if you write scripts or if you write, well, I'll just say scripts, television scripts or film scripts, because I do write in that genre, the way the stories often function, it's the main character whose obstacles drive the story. The side characters or the window characters, their narratives don't drive the story. And so if you have a black woman who becomes a window character or a side character, just by nature of how the storytelling is oriented, she's already put in the category where she can only go so far, right? And that's just plain old-fashioned storytelling. You know, so then if you make that character a black woman and then there's an expectation around it, as there should be, then the negotiation becomes, okay, well, if you want her to do more, she has to be the main character. Now, if she's a window character, and this is using screenplay language, they're always kind of supposed to mirror the main character. You know, they're supposed to, in some ways, these characters function as a way of showing what the main character is capable of or what they're not capable of, which already puts these side characters at a disadvantage. But then on top of that, if you make it a woman of color, and just women, period, there becomes this negotiation around their emotions. How do you deal with emotions? And in science fiction in particular, there's not always a range of, there's not room for emotions. In my film, Rayla, not my film, but my soon-to-be film one day, my book, Rayla 2212, I think one of the character's primary issues is how does she be this hardcore warrior princess, but then still connect to this aspect of femininity where she's connected to her intuition or connected to using feelings as a driver, right? And this is getting into feminine aspects of humanity, et cetera, but I think in a larger context, science fiction doesn't always know how to deal with emotion.
Well, and I think part of the problem is that we have constructed a white everyman, white everywoman, right? So sci-fi can deal with emotion. We will see feelings from the expected characters, right? So we can see, say, Buffy crying over her mom's death. We will see Willow's rage. We will see all of these things. But if you don't, as a writer, necessarily think of black people as fully human, it's super easy to have those side characters, because you see this a lot with not just with Michonne, with, I'm sorry, I'm about to have a whole vampire situation.
That's okay.
But the Suki Stackhouse thing, right? So we have Tara, and Tara meets the person who owned her family. And we have Bonnie on Vampire Diaries, who meets the person who owned her ancestors. And when they get mad at the vampires, who owned their ancestors, well, you're being prejudiced, you're not being fair. The fuck? Let me tell you, if time travel was a possibility and I could go back and look John Gamble, the man who owned my great grandmother, in the face, I might slap him in the mouth. Like, just on GP. So you mean to tell me that we have written a situation where this is someone who owned slaves? It's not the descendant of someone who owned, it's someone who actually owned slaves, who actually owned your ancestors. And you're not supposed to get mad because sexy, sexy vampire? Either you need to leave this trope alone with the Civil War era vampire, or you need to deal with the fact.
Speaking of, sliding into our next set of questions, and this is actually something that, you know, with what Mikki and Tasha were talking about that segues nicely, is that science fiction, fantasy, and geekdom is supposed to be a multitude. It's supposed to be this multiverse where anyone can be anything and everyone has potential. So what exactly is it that makes creators pigeonhole their black female characters into this strong warrior woman character, the Weather Witch character? I have ambivalent feelings about Storm, and that's putting it nicely. But that's what I mean. Like, we are so much more than what they have presented with us. And what's worse, they're in a genre where characters are supposed to be three-dimensional. Like, we're supposed to see grief from Michonne when she lost her baby. We're supposed to see elation from, I was about to list someone of N.K. Jemisin's books, but then I remember that, yeah, especially not the fifth season, like, wait, no. but yeah, we're supposed to see joy, elation, pain, sadness, and especially in a genre like science fiction and fantasy, why is it that these creators will stick to these tropes?
I think one thing that probably, you know, exacerbates this is that there's still, you know, this need for strong female characters. So I think that it can be so tempting to say, okay, well, I wrote this character of color and she's strong. I did it. I did the thing. I got the strong female character and she's a person of color. And it's like, but are there any other aspects to her personality? Is there anything else going on there? Is she, again, three-dimensional, well-rounded character? Or is it just, she's strong. I did it. Because I think it's like your heart is so close to being in the right place, but you just kind of miss the mark. And you miss the fact that this is often the one personality trait that gets attributed or gets ascribed to a black woman. And so I think that sometimes it can come from, oh, this is the only thing I know how to write, but also sometimes it can really probably feel like girl power when you're really just missing the mark.
I have a whole intersectionality thing, so if you have something
else. I also think that there's just a, you know, it's a reflection of the biases historically that are kind of, you know, placed upon black women. Black people, people of color in general. If in real life, I guess outside of the fiction world, you only think there are so many variations of a good or interesting kind of black woman, then that's the type of person you're going to write. If you think the most interesting kind, most sellable, most, I guess, the exalted kind of black woman is the kind that's funny and sassy and a little bit dangerous and she can be that because her white friend can't be that, then you know, if those are the friends that you think you're making because those are the, like, safe black women to be around, then that's going to be the, I guess, the person that you imagine will be a great character in your book, will be a decent person on your film series. And once again, it's one of those things where you're just reflecting what you think you know about society or people that you don't know or people that you believe you do know, and you're just creating that version of that person in your fictional universe. It's not a well-rounded person, but you think you're doing well onto them because that's the itinerary of virtues that are available for black women. They can be funny, they can be a little bit, you know, more dangerous, they can, you know ways around town, or that type of shit stuff.
This panel is rated PG-13, so
I mean, I'm gonna point out that part of it also is that, you know, the cultural zeitgeist is informed by the media we consumed, right? Like, we watch movies made at a certain time, and we see certain depictions. So you get Jezebel, right? And that's the sexy black woman. You get Memmi, right? You get Sapphire. Anybody who wants to look these terms up, ferris.state.edu, you can look at all these things from Jim Crow. Because a lot of this is tropes that come from minstrel shows. It has nothing to do with reality. It has to do with comforting racist tropes from Jim Crow America. And please don't say Jim Crow South, because it's not Jim Crow South, it's Jim Crow America. It's Jim Crow planet, actually. Because anti-blackness is global, and this is one of the things that gets constructed. If you need to envision during slavery black people as less human to justify the fact that you don't care about their grief, there's this scene in 12 Years a Slave where, I think her name is Patty, the white woman's name, I forget it on purpose every time, where she sees that the black woman's crying because her children have been taken from her, and she says, you'll forget about them soon enough. Because if you have to think of people as animals in order to justify your crimes against them, then you carry that forward and you teach those same things. You can see this play out. One of the reasons you don't see the grief of Michonne or the grief of Zoe is because we don't want to construct a world in which grief for black people is legitimate. So you'll see this play out in reality when a child is shot by the police or killed and you see a black family suing, you'll see those comments, right? Well, they're only suing, they just want money, they don't care. Well, what justice do they have available for them beyond that lawsuit in this country, right? So we are replicating real racism in our fiction, and then we say, no, I'm not racist, because somehow we've constructed racism to be running across the lawn, and Jim Crow, and the KKK, and not Miss Millie's version, where she looked at Sophia, who had not seen her children in a year, and said, but I need someone to help me drive back, and I can't be with these black people, these black men in my car, right? So that is, I think, the thing that is happening, is that we have all these unexamined biases, and we think we're doing a good job. Well, I'm not sure Josh thinks he's doing a good job. I have questions for Josh. I have a lot of questions. But we think that representation, any representation, this crumb, this moldy crumb in some cases, should be good enough because at least it's there. Well, that's not really representation, that's your racism. It's okay to call that out. It's okay to say that it's misogynoir, racialized misogyny, however you want to put it, because that's what's happened.
Yeah, I wonder, I mean, I think for me as a creator, just generally speaking, one of the reasons I became passionate about wanting to tell stories, and I really started off as a journalist, I wanted to tell stories that I didn't see, or maybe there were stories people would talk about in my household or perspectives of history, and I wouldn't always see these represented in mainstream culture. And at a very early age, and I'm talking, 10, I became very much aware that mainstream culture is not where I would look for validation. And then, within the literature created that was targeting, young black women or that were about black subject matter, supposedly. At the same time, I found them interesting and fascinating, but I still didn't see myself. And part of that had to do with the fact that I was reading things way too early that I shouldn't have been reading, like Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye. I read that at 11 thinking it was supposed to be about a woman who had blue contact lenses, and that is so not
blue. I read the book of Purple Ink, I understand.
Yes. So it was all these things, right? And so at some point, you read about missing histories, you read about absent histories, and I understood, okay, well, there's a narrative that's constructed that is not the accurate narrative, so I'm not even gonna look to it for that. And ultimately, I'm gonna tell stories that I think are interesting or help to recapture missing histories or help to capture things in the present so that future people would have a sense of what people were thinking now. That's why I went into journalism, which kind of leapfrogged me into Afrofuturism eventually. And I only say that to say that I, to some degree, I don't have an expectation of the images that are created in these contexts because I understand it's created to be sold to specific kinds of audiences for specific kinds of reasons. So I create, and that's not to create anything.
No, I'm saying, I think right. That you have a good point because I'm a creator too, and I create based on the history that I wish we saw more of.
Right. Totally creating there and creating worlds that are not necessarily connected to frameworks around dehumanization and racism as we understand it, because these things, our isms are very much creations and systems and technologies. In the context of Afrofuturism, we very much talk about race as a creation and as a society, while we talk about race kind of as this categorization system. It was a system created to justify the transatlantic slave trade, to dehumanize, and it was enforced through law and violence. So obviously we fought very much to neutralize that, but I like to create worlds where that's not always the framework so that I don't get stuck in trying to counteract images that are created for other purposes, right? Like some of the images we're talking about today, where I feel like, oh, I have to create the strong woman to counteract the not so strong woman in the narratives, or, oh, let me create the very vulnerable woman to counteract the woman who can't cry in these mainstream narratives. I just sort of think in that way because I don't want these constructions, which are designed for specific purposes to impact how I create, but then to impact how I even see myself. So, you know, I don't relate to these concepts, right? I can look at television as television and call it a day, but I understand that how problematic it can be at the same time. But that's because of a certain socialization. You know, other people look at television as a framework for reality. And that's kind of where we're going with some of these images. So I think for me, a lot of the empowerment becomes around people here, such as you and people on this panel, who are really looking around the creation and the celebration of creation that really reflects the humanization of people, you know, just overall, and not fully locked into some of these constructions and these storytelling constructions and narratives that ultimately dehumanize all of us.
And I think it's important to think in terms of, as we're creating, you know, I write sort of, it's not a rewrite, a retelling of history exactly, but it's sort of a magical realism of history, because I am a historian by training. And one of the things I think that's important is that, you know, on the other side, there's so much that we're losing because people do construct their idea of the past from what they see and not from what was really there. And I think that it's important to push against these ideas that, you know, the past is not white, the future's not all white, nothing is all white.
So this is actually a perfect segue into our intersectional representation question, because this quote is attributed to Whoopi Goldberg everywhere. I don't know if she actually said this.
She did.
Okay. So yeah, I found this piece of art and I felt that this was definitely something that I need to include in this slide, because when it comes to the creation of a lot of Black women characters, it's not just the strong warrior, whether witch Black women. They all seem to be heteronormative Black women. And most of us know that Black women don't come in one place in the sexuality spectrum. Black women also suffer from mental illness. Black women can also be persons of disabilities. Yet we don't see that type of intersection in a lot of creations that have Black women characters. And I'm wondering, where are they? Where are they? Where's the queer working class Black Latina who has anxiety?
You know, I think because the whole construction of images is still around trying to redress wrongs, you know, there is this idea of, well, let me create stories about the normal woman first, right? Since, again, you know, there's been this constant effort to kind of fight how Black people have been depicted since the invention of the blockbuster films with, you know, 100 or so years ago with Birth of a Nation, right? So, I mean, this is with the establishment of mainstream, with the establishment of film came the derisions of Black images in film. I mean, the two happen at the same time. So, you know, there's been this constant counteracting effort. And, you know, you can look back to films with Sidney Poitier or Bill Cosby, and, you know, all of these were about trying to create these images of the, and these are guy images, but I'm saying, or Julie, those films, that TV show as well, about creating the normal Black person who's just like the normal white person. And these were supposed to be images that would further integration, you know, at that time. So I think in some cases we're still sort of stuck around that, but I think it's changing.
I hope it is.
I think it's changing in the independent literature. Again, you know, when you're looking at indie writers and a lot of the pieces that they're putting together, I think there's a lot of fluidity, especially in the context of Afrofuturism. There's fluidity in gender expression that's starting to express itself more in literature. Definitely in imagery. I mean, if you're looking at people like a Grace Jones, right?
Yes.
Or even Janelle Monáe from just, and I can't get into their own identities per se, but just in terms of the personas that they put across, very gender fluid. And I think there's a comfortability
and Black culture around gender fluidity, but there's an uncomfortability until somewhat fairly recently around claiming it, right? You can do whatever you want to do, just don't talk about it, right? You know how to switch it up.
Well, and I think it's important to note that even when we're talking about Reclamation, that movie, at the exact same time that movie was being made, the first Black film was being made, and that movie was never distributed because there was a kissing scene between two Black people in that film. And at the time, Jim Crow etiquette, Black people could not show affection in public, right? So we constructed this world where they were made at the same time. We think of Birth of a Nation as the birth of film history. Literally, the exact same time, separate producers, separate thing, and they said, we can't put this out because they're kissing. And so then we look at that, and then you look at how we construct things around gender. Actually, these characters are often present, but they're present in very specific niche places, right? You can look at Bessie Smith, you can look at Stagecoach Mary, you can find all of these people in our history. The problem is that what we're taught in terms of history is often obscured by white supremacy and racism, and then we go forward with these images and we think, well, now we're recreating this first step. When we're not really creating the first step, we're having to recreate because there was a barrier to that first thing. So I think it's important when we're thinking about where is the Latina, she's right there. You just will wind up as J.K. Rowling did, where your diversity comes after the books are out. Where now we know Dumbledore was in love and had relationships, but we spend the whole book without even a hint of any of this. We spend a lot of the books without a hint of a lot of things. I have J.K. Rowling issues too. we get to Buffy. Like, we can go back and we can have this whole moment because...
Then I'm going to ask them if we can have room for the rest of the day.
But we have this whole thing where, yes, there was kind of diversity, but we have the Inca girl story with Xander and the racism. Right? Because those intersections matter. And those intersections are often erased and occluded because, yes, we got to see Willow date a girl, but first we had it be that Willow was interested in women via the vampire, the murderous vampire lens, right? And then we kill Willow's girlfriend. Why? Strangled it, no less. Tara also deserved better.
Alyne, Karlyn, do you have anything to add?
In general, there's been a prevalence of discourse about diversity and inclusion that was about celebrating commonalities to make white mainstream audiences more comfortable. And celebrating difference was seen as being divisive. And so the way to present, something progressive in terms of how do we integrate more people of color, as well as people who are along the gender spectrum, people who have, physical disabilities, how do we integrate them into these stories when we need to do it a little bit at a time? And if it happens at all, it needs to be subtextual, because we don't want to look like we have an agenda or anything like that. Because of course, the overlaying idea is that a lot of the character dynamics of who's important and who narratives revolve around is naturalized, unfortunately, right? That these characters that are presented as interesting and important and having X-Men universe, the biggest and brightest and most important powers. They're white because that's the way it is. They're men because that's the way it is. And you sort of take that in and you consume it. And if you question it, then it becomes your fault for caring, right? Like in reference to what's up here, the first time I woke up Saturday morning and saw Storm on the X-Men, and I was watching the cartoon like, the most important thing about liking that character was how much I wanted to be her more than I wanted to be anyone else on that show. I wanted her powers. She was the coolest. She was the most powerful. She seemed to be the smartest. And back then, I wasn't consuming it politically, but now. Now realizing that that was happening was so important and so vital and influences the way that I consume and critique media now. And I think that we're moving more towards having a discourse that celebrates difference and not being afraid of holding people accountable for creating these sort of naturalized narratives of who's at the center of these stories, that's the way it should be. We're getting better with that. And all of these, you know, and people who have been creating these stories about people of color, about people on the gender spectrum who have been erased, who have been downplayed, who have only existed on kind of this, I don't know, this alternate, this sort of alternative market of selling things to people who hopefully like the stories because they can't be mainstream, they're getting more pushed to the forefront a little bit more. Hopefully, they'll be in even more positions of power as creators, as people who are actually developing these films. And more importantly, there won't be this idea that, well, the mainstream audience doesn't want to hear those stories. We got to tell the stories everyone wants to hear. That's bullshit. Sorry.
No, I agree, and I love everything I'm hearing. It seems it's almost like there's this incremental steps of radicalness that we're able to kind of, you know, slowly walk up. So you know, you start off with, well, Black characters actually being seen in any capacity, and then those characters, you know, being good, you know, and actually laudable, having characteristics that, you know, are not, you know, just total propaganda, like going back to Birth of the Nation. And then, you know, it's going from seen to good to actually maybe complex in some capacity and likable. And so then getting to where you actually have real vulnerabilities and other intersections, and you actually start looking at just the whole universe of who a Black woman character can be, it feels like that's the step that we're just now getting to of like, and maybe it's not just that she's just as good as everybody else and just as nice as everybody else and also, you know, has her own personality. There's this other thing about her. And I feel like we're getting to that. And I recognize that as I'm going through a lot of the media in my head, I'm thinking of so many things that are largely, you know, white construction with Black characters in them. And I'm realizing how much I'm craving something like Afrofuturism, you know, where it's not just, let's look at what this Black character is doing, but it's like, no, let's look at this Black universe. Let's look at all of these Black people in this world. And I feel like there are probably a lot of amazing things happening there, and I'm just not aware of it because that's something I'm not as exposed to as I want to be. And I'm hoping that that's the answer, that that's where those characters are, and that they can, you know, obviously be represented more fully and beautifully and abundantly in other media as well. But my suspicion is that it's already happening.
Yeah, it's already happening. And I think it's been happening for a while. And I think the exciting thing is because of technology and social media, people are able to connect with these works faster because of Comic-Cons and how they've enriched themselves in recent years. You're able to meet different creators and see these works, you know, up front and in person. I think that one of the ultimate challenges, again, for creators is to take these so-called tropes and not feel like you have to actively fight against them as a creator. Because as a creative, you have to dig into yourself, your own sense of identity. And when I say identity, I just don't mean like your ethnic, you know, social status, that sort of thing. Just what story is being born within you? And the way we've been socialized around narratives is, you know, you have people disconnected from the stories that are coming to them because they're so busy trying to filter them through a prism to therefore be acceptable, you know, in a commercial sense. So the spaces that we are in now are way more radicalized, as you were saying, because people could say, wait a minute, I don't have to counteract a narrative. I don't have to justify a narrative. I just need to start first with what's coming out of me and let that character go where that character goes. Not go where I want them to go because as a Black person they have to fight injustice in a specific sort of way and you know, be a symbol for civil rights and all future change. That can be something that comes out of what you ultimately do. You don't just discard a certain set of responsibilities, but as an artist, which people of color, they've always been negotiating around this idea of being an artist because it's like, well, you can't create art for art's sake, right? Some people can create art for art's sake, but you have to do it to make a statement specifically. And so that's not a bad thing, but there is to say, there has to be room to connect with yourself, and as you connect with yourself, that story then connects with its audience. And I
think that we're embracing that more as a social value, as opposed to something that has to be justified through a narrative of consumerism. But I think we have to credit the audiences, because the reason these works are existing and able to have life is because you have audiences, such as the ones here, who are supporting and looking for it, and their voices are now accepted.
And that actually, if you don't mind, would like to segue into the last question really quickly for you ladies before we open up the panel. I think that's what the ultimate dilemma is. We talk about creators. Is it, can we only depend on ourselves as Black women to create us respectively and justly, or can we also depend on people who, non-Black people, not, you know, people, men, you know, can we depend on people who are not us to paint us in the light that we should be painted as human beings?
I think this is sort of a twofold thing, because I think that we can get it wrong. People who are not us can get it wrong in some very interesting ways, but also that there are folks, you know, so first I'm going to plug. I'm going to plug the Black Girls first. I'm going to plug N.K. Jemisin's fifth season. I'm going to tell you that as you're reading this book, there will be points where you hate this book. It's not because I'm writing. It's a beautifully written book. I hate her face because this book should be impossible. There's a level of skill here that just makes me want to fight her. She's one of my best friends. But oh my God, must be discounted right now. But also, that book is so good, and it creates this whole world, and it's not about pushing back against tropes. It is completely immersive in this world where, you know, yes, the Black women, and there are things, and it is happening, but it is not a retelling of anything remotely related to Toni Morrison, and I kind of love that. you know, Denny Okorafor does really great stuff, but also, and I'm going to give his little tiny head a plug, and no one can tell him I did this, DJ Alder, Daniel Alder. Salsa Nocturna, Shadow Shaper, he does some really great stuff with women of color. Don't tell him I complimented him.
Seriously. Like this is being recorded. Right?
Listen, we just can't let him see this tape. His head is big enough. He's my favorite pocket mouthy Cuban. But yeah, I think that we can look to others. I'm not necessarily certain that those others would be white.
Okay, so we've got 55 seconds until I open up for the floor. Does anybody want to do a lightning round with their thoughts about the last question?
I think depend is a really interesting word in this context. I absolutely understand the reluctance to depend on people who aren't Black women to write Black women's stories at, I guess, a level of, for lack of a better term, expertise. But I, at the same time, I would hope that there would be a desire to learn more about the nuance and the history and just the totality of Black women's experiences by other people, that they would be capable of doing it. And of course, Mikki's right, we get it wrong too sometimes. So should it be available to everyone? Yes, but would I trust someone else to be able to write the experiences with as much depth and nuance? No.
All right. If you don't mind, ladies, thank you so much. We're going to open up the floor for questions. And I love you, but Garnet is right there. So, Garnet, if you would like to.
So I'm trying to get into writing comic reviews very consistently, and any help on figuring out how can I identify a three-dimensional, well-developed female character, specifically a Black woman, so I know that they don't fall into the trope, because sometimes it is hard to identify if they are being a strong Black woman, or they can also be emotional too, but both of them seem bad.
I know that someone's written something about this, and I wish I knew who they were so I can quote it, but I'll just throw something out there. Do they have a family? You know, that there seems to be this idea that, you know, there's a Black women in some of these spaces, they're alone, they have no past, you know, they're surrounded by people who aren't necessarily of their culture, not that everything has to be about culture, but they're completely divided from it. And the only other person who they may encounter is a person of color who could be a possible love interest, but in many instances, not the same cultural background that they're a part of, right? So do they have a family? Do they have a love interest? You know, irrespective of gender, do they have a love interest? And do they have a sense of drive, a goal, a narrative that is that moves them from one world or one book to the next? I think, you know, these are things that are humanizing.
I would add, make sure that, are they the center of their own story, or are they just playing a supporting role in someone else's? Because a lot of times I've noticed this, the character will be slightly more nuanced, but then you realize after a while, wait a minute, you don't do anything on your own. You only turn up next to that person. Or you help that person move along, so.
And it's funny how it's almost a different face of like the manic pixie dream girl, where it's like, oh, you did these things and you made me feel so good and interesting, but wait a second, like, where was your life? What mattered to you? All you did was help our protagonist, like what?
I would echo everyone up here, especially what Mikki said about, is this person center of their own story? Do they have their own motivation? Do they appear to exist merely to constantly assist someone else's story?
All right, JP, you have a question?
Yeah, so I don't know if anyone watched DC's Legends of Tomorrow. So I just, I wanted to know your thoughts about the character of Hawkgirl and how characterizations on that show.
I just heard a massive sigh in the front row. So that thank you for reaffirming my decision not to watch.
I have not seen it, so I can't.
Yeah, I haven't been keen on. I've sort of watched.
So listen, I have pop girl issues in general, just as in general how the character is treated. Part of the problem I think I have is that we are apparently never going to get a hot girl that is like a fully realized person. Like I think I don't know if it's in her contract with DC that we will get close. We will breeze right up on hot girl being somebody you want to watch, you can kind of get invested in, and then we're just going to take a detour to the left. Because I have Justice League hot girl feels too, but that's what we do. Like, I let go, let God. That's what I'm telling you about hot girl.
Any other questions?
I would love it if y'all would assign us all some homework. Like, give us your favorite genre in whatever media. Is it a video game, a TV show, a book? Like, I mean, Fifth Season comes up all the time in my circle of friends, but give me something else that you have experienced that you loved and you want all of us to love too.
Have you read Sheep and Fear's Death?
No.
You need to
okay.
read it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll do some shameless self-promotion and say my book.
I actually just finished your book, and yeah, I'll get.
Oh yeah, and I'll shamelessly promote even though it's not out yet. We have a forthcoming Alice and Jazz line, me and my husband together, so you should totally get that when it comes out.
Mm-hmm. I'll circle back to that.
Yeah. Yes,
the person with the beautiful leg.
I have a question on Sleepy Hollow. And, well, actually, I'm sorry. It wasn't Sleepy Hollow. It was actually Walking Dead and Michonne. And Michonne and Rick, which was totally unexpected because I haven't read the comics. And my first thought when I saw that is, oh, she's going to be dead soon. So what are your all thoughts on that? And why, when we do have black women on these shows in general, why are they always with white men? Why can't we have black men and white men?
So that seems to be a Brian K. Vaughan thing.
Yes.
Depictions of black love that actually Sharina's post, but it is actually a weird idea that somehow this is better for diversity. That interracial love is the thing that needs to be depicted so that people will see us as human, because I don't know why we don't think that two black people together can be love. Like, I did not necessarily love the Martha and Mikki setup, but I was fine with Martha and Mikki as a couple, because Lord knows I did not want Martha to be set up with a doctor or any of the other white boys. It was just that I felt like, hey, you could have shown me. You spent 4 million hours on Rose and her feels and whatever, and I didn't care. You could have spent that time on Martha and the rest of Martha's eternal life, because then I would have cared about.
And then the assumption is that television viewers or moviegoers, mainstream, and when they say mainstream, they're usually talking majority white, will not go see a project with two black love interests. Because then it'll become a black film, which then means mostly black people will come and see the film. Other people will see it, but the majority of people will be black people, and then that's going to change how much money the TV show or the film is going to make, and it can't be the same global hit because it's now a black show. So if they really break it down to a certain kind of economics.
And Tyler Perry debunks all of that.
To a point, because Tyler Perry's projects, and generally speaking, when they talk about black films, they don't have the same overseas, they don't bring in the same numbers overseas, in part because of how they're marketed or that they're not marketed at all. But when they're creating these big budget projects, the goal is for them to make $1 billion plus, okay? So yes, if Tyler Perry's film makes $100 million in the U.S., that's great, but it probably made maybe 10, 15 overseas. You have a film in the United States that, let's say, it might make $100 million, then it might make 2-3 times that overseas, you know, or more. So the expectation around what they want to make when it's a mainstream blockbuster kind of film, or even if it's more of a rom-com kind of film or action film, it's a different scale, and it's strategically market-based. They're looking at a certain amount of numbers that they want to hit. So.
Well, I've heard that before, and I always point to things like Gods of Egypt, which went well,
well, that's because now the world is changing. The world market is changing a bit, so obviously you're going to have to make shifts with that. You know, some things are just plain old-fashioned unacceptable. especially now. But that's a kudos to the world and to the audience to reject that kind of project and say, look, you know, we all know that Egypt, people in Egypt had a different look about it. You know, this is not a different time. So I really think that, you know, the geek community should kind of, in some ways, pat itself on the back for really challenging these things and being so vocal.
I have more thought. I have so many feelings about this.
I didn't want to interrupt any of you ladies because you ladies have been magnificent, but I believe we have one more minute about. So
I can be so concise. Contrasting, you know, Rick and Michonne with Mikki and Martha. The thing about Mikki and Martha that I found particularly insulting was that, you know, you get to see the life of Martha Jones, you get to see the life of Mikki, you get to see them separately, you don't get to see any of the courtship, and it felt a lot like it's the two black people, you love it, come on. You know, you don't get to actually see the depth of any of their growing together. It's just kind of a retcon of like, they were together, and of course you accept that, because they're both black and that was going to happen. It felt like an eventuality that was very insulting to us as people that had grown to love both characters separately. With Rick and Michonne, I'm definitely aware of a lot of pros and minuses about all of this, but what I love is that you've seen two characters that for 6 seasons you've seen grow together, you've seen fight together, you've seen mourn together, you've seen them do so many things. And so for some people, they saw it coming a mile away, some people never saw it coming. But what I loved was that it wasn't just saying, oh, these two, they have all these things, they're each other's family, but they're never going to be love interests because they're different colors. For it to be like, actually, no, this made sense, and they shared this full-bodied history that we've had the privilege to see. That's all that I really want, is for a black female character, especially a dark-skinned one, to be able to have that and it not be like, of course she's not going to be the love interest because she never is. I think that was concise.
All right, I just got the flag that says that our time is up. I want to thank my awesome panelists, especially our panelists. Can catch Ytasha in the meat space here at the con still. Thank you, and have a wonderful CTV to you. Thank you.
I know. I had an interview in half an hour.
I don't know.
Yeah, you need to read all.